We all know what a challenge and a joy it can be, captured in that deceptively simple phrase, a year in the garden. Get it right, and you can give yourself boundless pleasure. Get it wrong, and imagine the frustrations and annoyances that lurk from compost heap to herbaceous border that creep across lawn and vegetable patch when your back's turned. Well, in the next couple of hours, we're going to be taking Gardener's Question Time through the seasons, on a mission to help you get things more right than wrong in the future. Joining me, Eric Robson, here in the potting shed, will be the whole Gardener's Question Time team, armed with advice on everything from plants and planting to pests, diseases, design and seasonally topical tips. So, just conjure up the scene. You're looking out from the potting shed on a wintry garden, a frosted architecture of triumph and failure. There's the rhymed wisteria that flowered for the first time this year. That's the solitary triumph. Of course, the other list is longer. Over there, the rambling rows that didn't. In that far corner, the sad vegetable beds that should have been cleared a month ago. Here, the patch of permafrost, where, as only you know, lie dahlia tubers that should have been lifted and stored. And all about plants that you hope wishful thinking will bring through another winter. But look on the bright side, because at least you're taking time to look. The gardening year starts here, in the company of Matthew Biggs, Bunny Guinness and John Cushnie, shivering in the potting shed with me as we address some of the key gardening questions of winter. And this really is the starting blocks for the gardening year, isn't it, Matthew?
Yeah, it certainly is. I mean, there's never really a lull. In fact, I do have a little bit of a rest over Christmas, I have to say. I like to put my feet up. But even then, a chance to nip round the garden, have a look and see what's in flower is always there for the taking.
John Cushnie?
Yeah, and a little goes a long way. In the summer, you have to have masses of flower, and yet you just find one plant in bloom whenever you stand around the garden, as Matthew says, and you're happy. It's fantastic.
Billy?
For me, it's the most exciting time of year, because rather than putting my feet up, I like to redesign or redo one area and get some structural work done.
Now then, with winter approaching, some plants, especially those in containers, will certainly need a bit of help to survive the cold. So, Matthew Biggs, what's the best way to protect them?
Well, in an ideal world, you'd shift everything into a frost-free greenhouse or shed, and that includes all your hardy plants, because you're thinking not only of the plants themselves, but also of the containers. Generally, we go out and buy the containers from the garden centre, terracotta. Some people say that their product, in fact, is frost-tolerant, but given that the temperatures can get really low, that it can even damage them. So in an ideal world, they would all be protected. If you've got hardy plants growing out in containers, the key thing really is to protect the pots and to raise them off the ground to help the drainage. And I also move mine and put them all in the shelter of a wall where they're away from the frost and the cold wind and also the excessive rainfall that can happen during the winter time. And I tend just to wrap the containers with bubble wrap or with Hessian to protect anything that's, as I say, glazed pot or terracotta. The plastic ones, it doesn't matter so much, but it's still worth pursuing that idea, because again, there's always the chance that the root ball can get very sodden and frozen. So it's just a matter really of protecting the plant and the container. The containers that I've got with hostas and similar herbaceous plants, they normally get dumped in the bottom of a hedge and covered with leaves. That gives them good protection. And I've got a little corner where there's some evergreen hedge. That helps too. And it's also a west-facing site. If you've got an open hedge where the base is very open and it's cold wind cuts underneath, then obviously that's you've got to make sure that you give some protection. The other thing too is to create windbreaks around them. You can either put up netting around those pots or group small pots together and then cover them with horticultural fleece. If you've got plants that are hardy in most winters, but if it gets particularly cold are likely to get scorched, particularly damaging the leaves like myrtles, for example, I not only wrap the pots, but also then wrap the individual plants in fleece and just peg them together. The thing that you must avoid doing is wrapping them in something like plastic or thinking that bubble wrap will help them, because in the end what will happen there is that you will just end up with a mush. They will just rot away. If you've got plants like alpines in troughs, then again, any of the cushion plants that are liable to collect water in amongst the leaves, and again, they're likely to rot, you can just put little cloches over those. So really, it's just making sure that the water can't get into either the pots themselves to do damage, that the wind is actually stopped from scorching tender leaves, and that the plants can at least just hang in there through the winter.
John Cushnie?
Well, yeah, because we get it not only wet, but we get hard frost as well. And I found a great way is to plunge, especially when Matthew was talking about the plastic pots, where it can actually penetrate right through into things like agapanthus and stuff, where you can actually damage the roots. I just plunge them in sand. I have a big pit of sand, which I find useful for a dozen and one things. And in the wintertime, I just plunge them into that. That gives them protection.
And bunny guineas.
Yeah, and one thing that people hate with this sort of thing is you look at it, a load of fleece and things like that, and it can look a real mess. So I think what I tend to do is I make a wigwam over the pot with tender plants, and this might be out of hazel sticks, or I get my blacksmith to make me up something that looks quite attractive. And then when you see the forecast, you think it's going to be really cold tight, you've got ready-made sort of almost night dresses made out of fleece that you can just slip over them and slip off, because there aren't always that many days when they need it, and you know, that real cold weather for some plants. Another thing I've seen for some really nice unusual palms is you can actually have heated cables and actually heat an environment outside, but you obviously want to be careful and get a good electrician to help you with that.
And that's posh.
That's the posh and expensive option.
But yes, it's worth it for something really special, isn't it?
Now, one of the delights to me of winter in the garden is seeing, you know, wild birds coming to the bird table, seeing that sort of mass of wildlife coming closer to the house windows. But some people seem to be better at attracting birds and wildlife to the garden than others. So, John Cushnie, what should we plant to encourage birds into the garden, having tempted them in? How do we keep them there?
Well, I mean, this isn't really difficult. I have a problem in that they just clean everything on me. And I do look after the birds. I put lots out, but I can never put enough. I mean, and if I can take it as almost a pecking order, I find that sorbus, ordinary sorbus occiperi, and the good sorbus, you know, the beautiful ones like edulis, they go like snow off a ditch. They're the first to go. And then my paracantha on the wall, yellow, orange, red, it doesn't matter. Birds clean those. They love them. And then comes the big, after that would be the really big cotoneaster, the things like carnubia and frigidus and bilatus. They wipe those out. And, you know, right through, and I mean, the last thing that goes with me is the holly. But the bad news, Eric, is that even it goes before Christmas. By the time Christmas is over, I don't have a berry for them. The melis have gone. Everything else is gone. So really, there are lots of berries, lots of fruit you can leave for the birds. But it's getting the birds to have the wit to stretch it out.
It does depend on the season as well. I mean, the berries disappear quicker in some seasons than others. But what sort of things would you plant, Bunny Guinness, to attract wildlife into the garden?
Things like teasels and sunflowers are good because of the seeds. The finches love pulling those seeds out. And also things like apples. Now, we're all very good and we clear up all the apples, but if you actually leave some apples on the ground, I know it's bad from disease, but the birds and things do love picking up the slugs and things in those. Hawthorn and sloe, I think, are terrific, and they really go for those first with me. Mind you, with the sloe, I've usually got them first for the sloe gin.
And Matthew?
The other thing that I've done, in fact, is planted some evergreens, groups of evergreens, because even in the hardest weather, there always seems to be little patches of ground underneath where the frost and the cold doesn't get to. So there is that protection. At least allows the birds to scrabble around and pick their way through there.
And so I suppose one of the lessons is don't be too tidy in the garden. Mm. If you're too tidy, you're not going to be creating a wildlife-friendly environment. A common feature of modern life, even in the garden, is noise, whether it's traffic, children, roadworks, aircraft, or the more acceptable chatter of a wireless tuned to Radio 4, of course. You can't get away from noise. But is there anything we can do as gardeners to, in a way, soundproof our gardens and create a bit of winter peace and quiet? Bunny Guinness.
A lot of people think that tree screens really do knock back noise, and I think experiments show that if you have something like 50 to 30 metres of dense tree planting about 12 metres high maximum, it will reduce the sound, but only by about 6 to 10 decibels. And that level
is... And that's three times the size of most people's gardens anyway.
Exactly. That level is actually not a huge amount, but who has got 15 to 30 metres? But a solid barrier, like a fence or a wall, is much, much more efficient. But you see, the thing is, if you don't actually see the noise, you don't realise it's there nearly so much. That's a big psychological factor. So I think the best way in a confined space is to mix the two and have some sort of raised hedge bank type thing, a bit like you have in Cornwall. And you could build it with fencing stakes on either side, battered, sloped, pushed into the ground, maybe up to a metre high. Fill it with earth, with maybe black polythene down the edges, and weave hazel on the outside so that the soil isn't going to fall between the gaps, and plant it up with a hedge. And a hedge with nice, big evergreen leaves is going to be better than one with small leaves, something like Prunus lusitanica or something like that. Birdsong is also, and running water, water features, all very good at actually masking sound.
John Cushnie?
Yeah, well, I would have two ideas in that. The first one is what the Continentals do with their airports and everywhere else, and what we did at Sparsholt on the top of where we're...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.